Oh, in my role as vice chair, I will mourn the loss of our wonderful chair, Downey, who we will all fondly remember as leading us to good work and doing such good stuff. But his job and his school committee, and I think he's on like 9 other committees too.
Well, being a parent and all that.
I thought we'd switch the agenda around just a little bit to begin by welcoming our new member. And maybe, Jack, you can introduce yourself, what brings you here, then we can do a quick go around with our names so that you can begin to get familiar with us.
Okay, I'm Jack Finn. I'm representing the Conservation Commission here, but I'm a lifelong resident of Northampton and grew up here and live on King Street above A to Z Science and Learning Store. And I'm happy to be here. It's exciting projects ahead.
So I'm Tony Hockstadt, and I live on 3rd Street, and I'm here as the appointee of the Northampton Housing Authority. We have a seat here.
Could you speak up? I'm sorry.
I'm so sorry. So I said I lived on 3rd Street, and that I'm the appointee for the Northampton Housing Authority. I'm filling our seat.
And I'm Devin Bruce, which is a nickname for a southerner who didn't want to be Debbie Sue.
Is that really your name?
Well, my brother thought it was. So I raised some kids and they gave me a nickname, Devin, and I've kept it as I've been around town. I'm on the planning board, so like you're coming from conservation, I'm coming from planning. And I wish I'd been a lifelong resident, to tell you the truth. I've been here 10 years. Committed to staying, that's the news.
Brian Adams, I live on Arlington Street off Massasoit, and I am appointed by City Council, and I'm the vice chair of this committee. In the absence of the chair, I'll guide us through this meeting.
I'm David Drake, I'm chair of the Historical Commission. Live a couple of doors away from F.J. Rogers bike shop and just wonderfully close to the Florence bike shops. So I can smell purple already. And I think with Downey's pressure, the longest I'm suffering, a member of this board, but welcome aboard and I think you'll enjoy it.
I'm Dave Rostein. I live in Florence, and I am one of the 2 elected members of the committee. Welcome aboard.
And I'm Linda Morley. Somehow, I'm a mayoral appointee. I'm not exactly sure how that happened. And I live on Prospect Street. Now I'm no longer the newbie because Tony's here, and now I guess I'm an old hand now.
That's it. And Jack, we're missing 2 members. One is, you didn't say that?
What? I was wondering who the other elected member was, so you'll tell me.
That's Marlene. Is not here tonight, and it's our other elected, of which we will be voting in November for those 2. And I believe Marlene has expressed that she is not running against me, correct?
She's not. So also just an interesting update on that. We only have 1 person who got enough signatures to be on the ballot. So the other elected position will turn into a city council until the next election.
Wow. Does that mean we're losing someone else on this committee?
We are.
I did not take out the person.
Okay. You didn't take out the person.
So who's the other, help me remember who's the other, Marlene and who's
well,
up here?
Marlene and Dave are our 2 elected representatives.
But who else is
Recreation.
Here?
Oh, Recreation.
We do not currently have a rec department member. Anne-Marie was going to forward a name to City Council. She hasn't done that yet, so I'm not sure what's happening with that. But hopefully we'll get someone to put around to really get going.
So Dave, we're sorry that you're not. Is there a way that we can get a write-in? Can you write people in?
Maybe he'll be the appointee.
Yes.
For a year.
What's next on the agenda?
But you serve through the middle of January, is that? So you'll be through this?
The end of this round.
The end of this round.
Or maybe is it January?
The end of the year, yeah.
So we'll make our recommendations by December.
Yeah, we have you January 2016 as expiring. General public comment, as there is none, we will move on. So we need both a chair and a vice chair of this committee. And it's been a while since we elected folks. How do we run that? Sarah, can you refer?
Someone should make a nomination for one or both of those positions.
I'd like to nominate Brian Adams for each chair. Discussion. He's speechless.
I've been chair of the science department at the school I teach at, and now co-chair, and everyone says, oh, we're honored to be chair of the science department. And the reality is, no one wants to do it. You know, it's a shit job. You get stuck with all this stuff. And I think it's probably the same here, but that being so, I am certainly willing to take it on in the absence of any other interest by anybody else. We do need an active co-chair. Is there
our longest serving member might be well trained.
Oh, I bet our would you be interested in it?
I feel like I've already given by swapping out TPC for this one and keeping two subs for the planning board.
I mean, that's just because that it makes sense for me to do it for the rest of this round. So I've got some other commitments that are going to take some time.
That's
no.
The primary duty of the vice chair is to act as the chair in the chair's absence. That's pretty much it.
What? Are you saying I did nothing all these years?
No, I didn't. There were several times in the chair.
I think there was once. But
you did your own house and took the service protection, but that's about it.
So, Linda, will tell me. I'm sorry.
No, you can get the answer, Nancy. Yeah. I would do it if there were no other interests, but I'm not putting to it. I certainly would be willing if there were no other interests, but I need to honor her on the
same day. If someone could, I'm also thinking. My dad was from the South, and he used to tell the story of the fellow who had been run out of town, hung from a rail after we tarred and feathered, and he looked up at the two fellows of either end and said, you know, if it weren't for the honor of the thing, boy, they'd much rather walk.
Well, we are just embracing this leadership role. Tony, any interest?
I am going to decline for a couple of reasons. One is I don't even feel like I understand the chair's entire responsibilities. And two is I think once you're vice chair, everyone looks at you as the chair next. So I'm just going to have to say no when that day comes.
You have to do it if you want to.
Well, I've heard from Linda that she would only do it if there was no other interest. You seem to have just a little bit more interest. So
is there a nomination? Like
she, only because she's saner than me.
I'd like to nominate David for service.
Is there a second?
Second.
So do we have a slate?
Can we just at least have the discussion?
By acclamation.
Say it before we vote.
Comfortable might be too strong a word.
Not parliamentary. Any objections to the...
Any objections to that slate? Is that what we're doing and discussing it?
And then you can have a call for election nomination by acclamation.
Did we answer your question?
Yeah, everybody, you're comfortable
in
the seat of leadership.
Yes. So what did you just say about the process? Declaration by acclamation? That sounds pretty cool.
Affirmation. Election by affirmation. Everybody basically agrees.
Okay. Whatever Dave just said, yes.
All
in favor?
Yes.
Anybody opposed? All right, here we go.
Can I just have a word, though? We sound like
we're all just being drugged around to do our civic duty. And in fact, I mean, the town run, I'm doing this for the benefit of anybody who might be listening. The town runs off of these kind of volunteer committee works, and it takes a lot of time, and people should realize that you don't want all of the city employees doing all of this instead. You want citizens involved. So it's almost a plea for spread it around. I mean, all of us are doing more than one committee, and so we could use more people. Thank you.
And it is an honor to serve on this committee. We do wonderful work, all of us. We always have, and we always will. So that's it. Any other discussion on that? Approval minutes, I believe it's the June ones, is that correct?
That is correct.
Yes. Is there a motion to accept the June, whatever that be? Second. Any discussion? All in favor? Right. Q&A for CPA applicants. If needed, there are no applicants present. So we will move on to, boy, we're just zipping through here. If Downey was here, we'd still be on the general public.
I know, it's a new regime.
We'll be out of here by 7:20.
Write that down.
Financial overview, Sarah.
All right, so it's a little rough at this point because we don't know exactly what the state match is going to be, for the benefit of anyone who is newer or may have forgotten. Our local match comes from property taxes, and the state match comes from a mixture of things, mostly which is receipts from the registry of deeds. So we're estimating our total available of funds that can actually be spent on projects to be on the low end, about $1.1 million, and at the high end, $1.2 million. And our total CPA requests total $1.15 million. So essentially these applications are asking for all of our money that is available for the whole fiscal year.
I'm sorry, but that is...
For the bonds.
So that includes the bonds taken off the top. So we would have $217,450 in bond payments. That's already been subtracted.
Can you repeat that?
Let's go with the minimum amount. So the minimum amount that we're going to have is $1 million.
Oh, no, I'm sorry. I wanted to get the bond number again.
$217,450. But actually available for projects will have $1,136,000, give or take.
So, and you, just to reiterate, you are quoting us that we usually do this in two rounds a year.
That is correct.
And so she's talking about the entire annual. So in most day and time, we would say, let's try to target half of that.
That's been half of that, that's correct.
With the exception of last year, we had last year.
We've done it differently, but just to put that number in perspective.
So, Sarah, that takes us to the end of the state fiscal year, which is June 30th, 2016, is that correct?
Yes.
Is that the city fiscal year as well? Mm-hmm.
So we do the funding round based on a calendar year, so even though it says this is round two, it's really round one of the fiscal year.
So we have just as much enough money if we were to approve everything that came in to cover it with absolutely nothing left for round two.
That is correct.
You've taken off the 5% or whatever.
Yeah, so that includes, I didn't give you the set aside, but 10% of each of those will be set aside for each program area, and that also includes our debt service and our administrative account. So the number I gave you was just available for project. And I'll send you more as we know.
Questions for Sarah? Comments?
Sarah, do you have, I know it's informal, but do you have any insight on upcoming projects that might be hitting our way for the second round?
I haven't heard anything. Sometimes that doesn't mean much, but I don't know of any really big stuff as far as I know.
When does the state's contribution become clear?
Sometime this fall. It depends on when things are voted on, so hopefully something.
But at a minimum, we have $1.1 million.
Yes.
And the administrative costs in the
planning office cover 1.5 positions? Or is yours covered by something else also?
It's not 1.5, it works out being less than one. I'm only half-time, and John Fry, who also does the financial pieces and the other behind-the-scenes stuff, is less than half-time.
Okay.
Any other questions for Sarah or comments in general about our upcoming fiscal year finances? Okay, moving right along to be looking at the small grants applications and to make funding recommendations. Hopefully folks got their packets from Sarah and noticed that there were our first two small grants applications in this packet. Dave, can you refresh our memory in terms of what we decided on as the process of small grants and what our task is tonight?
Our task is, as best we can, to make a funding decision on any of these and put it forward to the City Council separate from the regular or the traditional grant. And if there are any that we feel should bump into the traditional round because we have questions or there's some other concern about it or it doesn't meet the criteria, then we can do that here as well. That was the objective. And if there were folks here, we had said it's not mandatory that they participate, it's not mandatory that they show up, but if they're here and they want to come, then they could.
Do you want to do like a three-sentence overview to Jack as to why we initiated this new format?
I'm happy to. So I think we recognized a long time ago that we have a number of very savvy applicants who come in for very big ticket items. We often have repeat customers who come in looking for additional funds, and that has, for in terms of just people embracing the CPA, it was somewhat off-putting. And also in terms of getting people's applications in for smaller type projects or smaller groups or groups that don't have grant writers, they don't feel like they've been able to compete, and it's been a disincentive to get applications from a broader applicant pool and also a broader project pool. And so decided it would be worthwhile trying to have somewhat more of a streamlined process for projects that are somewhat self-explanatory, that don't require a ton of questions, don't require a lot of site visits, to try to encourage a little bit more ownership over CPA and CPA funds and their expenditure, also get more people in to do some projects that we haven't been seeing. And so it was geared more towards, and we can share the small grant write-up we have, but the smaller projects like some historic preservation. If there's an entity that has a number of historic documents and they need to get classy memos or storage devices or some kind of.
So it's $3,000.
$3,000 is a request of us with the project to total of up to $6,000, which can come from a match, although match isn't required by any means. So it's basically, you should be able to look at it, make sense of it, it should be digestible, and you should be able to do a direct call without a lot of worry about the consequences, but also some assurance that you think it can be done, it can be done well. And that they would adhere to all of the other application criteria that we have in our plan in terms of satisfying the types of projects that we can entertain using CPA funds. So that, you know, we've got some historic stuff, we've seen invasive species that we have before us, maybe school groups doing bird boxes, that lots of different things people can be creative. We didn't give them just a list of things. We gave them a list of things as examples. And hopefully with some creative marketing on our part and getting out in the community, we'll see more people engage and take ownership of it. So this is kind of the first ones that we're seeing coming into it.
So you have set aside a certain amount for this? Or is it flexible?
Yeah, we had talked about the different, there were so many different ways we could have done this. And it was kind of, we tried to do it all by consensus so people felt comfortable with the way we rolled it out. But we decided not to set aside money, but to reserve a special time at the beginning of the round where we would only entertain these, where we would make these recommendations time where we knew what the total ask was and knew what the rest of the projects were. That makes sense.
And Dave was our point person in devising this proposal for level work.
So it's nice to see that we got some interest.
Yes.
Period.
Great. So we will discuss them individually. How about the first one could be the shrubland and restoration in Mineral Hills Conservation Area put forward by the City of Northampton Conservation Commission. Asking for the full amount, $3,000, to be brush hogging, I believe, and mowing in an attempt to restore this grassland, shrubland, brushland habitat. So everyone help me out. How do we do this? We have a motion. Do we immediately put a motion on the floor and then discuss? Is that how we've done? Yeah. Okay. So.
I move we approve $3,000 for the Mineral Hills Invasive Removal and Shrubland Restoration Project. I'll second. And that just basically that just gets us in discussion.
And Tony seconds. Discussion?
I'm supportive of this. I just thought it was interesting and something to watch in the future small grants that both of them came in exactly at $3,000 maximum for the request for CBA funds and $6,000 for the project. And the one that's not in front of us, I think it fully described the project in order to get it within $6,000. So I think that's just something we should pay attention to and watch. We knew we were rolling this out. We didn't know what the right figure was. It was interesting to me, and just a note to pay attention to that in the future. But in terms of the project itself, I think it's good.
More discussion?
I like the project a lot. You know, as a wildlife biologist, you know, I'm appreciative of any work that we can do for wood turtles and grass and birds. I feel like this one might be more appropriate for the traditional round, just from my perspective, because I have more questions about how it interrelates with other aspects of this development of this bookend parcel and how it relates to everything else. As I go over my concerns, but I feel like there are kind of some mixed messages in the application. So, you know, on the one hand, it's talking about preserving things for birds. On the other hand, it's talking about leasing the land to farmers and how they would accomplish having birds there while they're either doing haying or making sure that everything is consistent. Or if you have, you know, you're preserving it for turtles that are walking across a field during the summer where they acknowledge that's the breeding season, how do you do that when you have that machine there? So part of the time is your restrictions and things like that. But I think for me, the biggest question isn't that, because I think it's a very worthwhile project and the budget seems appropriate. The concern I had was that we've given, I believe, the CONCOM about 30 or 30 plus thousand dollars to work on the overall summary of the threats to our land, and they're working on that. And to quote that application that we approved last time, develop recommendations to develop options for the CONCOM to consider so that they can have targeted informed reaction to invasive species problems, so they can intelligently and proactively address those and identify a highest priority recommendation. So my concern is we're getting one application without looking at the whole to figure out how this project fits in the larger scheme. And I feel like that doesn't mean we shouldn't fund it, but I would like an opportunity to either get back report if it's complete or make sure we have an understanding from CONCOM and from Wayne why this is a priority and how it relates to what the CONCOM expects to do on the whole thing. It's my impression from when we left that conversation about the larger project is that we would then see a large proposal for here's what we want to do in the case of kind of citywide in terms of our priorities. And we're going to be discussing, do we do some kind of fund, do we go in lump sum, recognizing what the priorities are. And this feels like it's a good project. I just don't know where it falls. It feels like it's kind of segmenting out of the larger thing. And also, it's unclear for this particular parcel. It actually says in the application that it's one of many things that needs to happen in the future of this parcel. And so it feels like it's kind of segmenting one aspect without knowing how the rest is going to be. That's my view of it. But I also feel like it's a good project, type of project that we meant to entertain here. It just comes with some baggage.
I think all data points are good ones, as they always are. I also think that and the city is successful in sequestering and pieces of land and beginning to show stewardship over them. We're going to have associated costs like this that begin to come along because of our stewardship. And this looks like stewardship to make it sort of maintaining it and keeping it healthy. People who are much brighter than I am in the area of conservation have looked at this. The Conservation Committee, I see, is a strong recommendation. Noted local naturalist supports it, a woman we all trust. And because it's not a huge request, I think I'd support Dave's request for some bigger picture to see where this fits in to the broader long-term role of stewardship. So that we can understand whether similar requests are going to begin to occur with other parcels, whether we should budget for that, or the state piece. But this seems to be a responsible proposition, and it's a very modest one, and I'll support it.
Sarah, can you speak to Dave's thing of concern about when this report that we funded will come out?
It is actually complete, and I can send everybody the link right now. And the portion that's included as an attachment is a part of that report.
And have you read it?
I've read most of it. I haven't gone through every single conservation area. It's very comprehensive, and it's a great plan and tool.
And do you feel it would be helpful for us to read before we
And if you're curious about what other types of management are recommended for other areas, definitely. But it seems like we already support it.
Can I ask you one more question? Does that report that you're sending to us prioritize?
It doesn't.
It doesn't.
So I've got questions about whether this is a stopgap. I'm thinking the reason they put it in the small grants was under the hope to go ahead and get some bush hogging done this fall. And if that's the thinking, I'd like, you know, those are the kind of questions I'd like to ask the applicant. Maybe ConsCon can tell me that. But I'm not bothered that we don't have the full action plan itemized yet, because I think there's a lot of work between Lori's report and here's the game plan of how we're going to need to approach it. And I think that'll take some time. So in that sense, I'm not bothered by doing this piece separately, and I'm not bothered by doing it this fall if there's an inherent reason to do it. I wonder, though, kind of like the question about the $3,000, I wonder if it's, you know, if we're just new to this small grants thing. Did they think by putting it in as a small grant, it was going to go through quicker and faster and earlier, and that what they make could get the mowing done? If that's a reason, it's a good one. But I mean, that's the kind of thing I think we're going to have to ask. And is it really a $10,000 project that they can only ask for three, and they're going to ask for pieces of three? You know, we're just going to have to feel our way through this.
Tony?
I don't have anything to add at the moment. I just comment a bit, so now Linda and Devin have both commented on this, of sort of what do we have before us, and I think those are good questions to keep in mind, and I think actually Dave touched on it as well. What's the big picture for this project. And, you know, I feel like my, so I guess I have a question of what do we do if we have questions and they're not there to respond to and require that. And I feel like, you know, the due diligence would be to actually read the report that puts this in context. Kind of better sense of it. You know, I picked up on the possibility of using the land too and wondered that.
Jack, did you have a chance to look at this, or can you offer insights?
Yeah, I looked at it. I got the same feeling of it. It was stewardship, you know, and like any valuable piece of property, that it's an ongoing process. And I think Lori has kind of laid out the desire to get some of the habitat back and to produce what it did before when it was more open space. And that might require a lease. It doesn't bother me that we would lease some land to a farmer that would, certain species would benefit from that. But I think it is a beginning point, and it seems like she made the case that it's a valuable location in the city. And if we could start at this point, we would be way ahead rather than waiting for a bigger push. But I could see this needing more money down the line to take it to the next point and the next point. So I think it is an ongoing stewardship piece.
It would be great if that could be a matter of discussion on the agenda for the Conservation Committee.
Yeah.
So that I think it would be to their advantage, frankly, because then there would be a planful approach to that.
Yeah.
I'd like to say I'm disappointed that our first two small grants turned out to be exactly the kind of things that we would have considered as larger. You know, we often do invasive species control request grants, and so I'm disappointed in that sense. But are we going to do what we usually do, which is prepare questions for the applicants?
I guess it depends on when the team wants to do it. I don't think that's what initially we envisioned, but that doesn't mean we couldn't.
Okay. Oh, because this is a small.
Yeah, so I mean, the idea would be if you felt like you could do it tonight and then agree with the folks to make the recommendations forward. If not, then we'll put it in with all the other ones and do Q&As.
I just have a feeling that there's a good reason why they wanted to do it this fall, and if I could just ask them and they could make a case that yes, it matters to do it this year, it will be more expensive next year, or it will be, you know, and
more,
that's
more overgrown.
Yeah. So that's the I'm actually in favor of the project. That's not I think we're all talking about the small grant process and that sort of thing.
And nowhere did we read what the rationale was, that if there was a rationale to make sure it got done this fall. Did anyone see that? I did.
Well, just in the sort of summary on page 4, and it says explain the various steps of the project and when they will be completed. They wrote, we will begin work on the detailed plan as soon as funding is awarded and complete the tasks identified therein as called for, and some activities are seasonally dependent.
I think Dave's question is a very good one, and as I've now sat on the committee for a little while, I'm seeing that there's sort of some repeat customers, and I do think that invasive removal has the potential for a lot of repeat customers, particularly the city, and I think it would be difficult to kind of take on the stewardship for all of the conservation lands in the city. So an effort to have that discussion and really get some prioritization from the Conservation Commission and with Wayne, so that we really are saying we need you to do this work for us. You can't assume that this responsibility is largely going to be transferred over to the CPA funds. Having said that, it's short money. It's $3,000. Invasives only get worse. They don't get better. So I guess I wouldn't angst about this $3,000. I would say, let's celebrate that we can do the small grants, do this one, but make sure that we have that discussion because there's going to be more of them.
seems like it's more than invasive. I mean, the brush hogging is to restore the pasture land that is a habitat, and that part of the city used to be more open habitat in the past, so that I think they're trying to restore that, so it's more than invasive. But I agree that I would like to get a better understanding, too, of being new on the Conservation Commission, to the priority list of the areas that are under its control.
Can I ask you a question? I think, because what I read in the Gazette is that there's an effort in the city for reforestation and of the city, which some people would say has already occurred, and others say needs to be greatly encouraged. But if we're giving money for preservation of pasture land, it seems to be at odds that if there's some simultaneous city effort for reforestation, because they're not the same. Should there be a single policy or some overarching way to rectify those apparently different goals? Sarah, do you?
The Agricultural Commission, as well as the Conservation Commission, identified a few areas where restoration of agriculture would really make sense. There's not a lot of them, and this happened.
Okay.
And my understanding is the reforestation is more urban trees and street trees rather than...
That's good. Thank you.
The thing I would offer is, you know, this is clearly not a one and done, whether it's invasives or maintaining shrubland. I believe, and Sarah, correct me if I'm wrong, or Jeff, that in Fitzgerald Lake Conservation Area, Cook's Pasture, there's a mowing regime. I think it's like a third every year, is it? And so you go 2 years or 3 years without mowing, and then you come back to the third that is mowed. So the fact that we're mowing now or paying to mow now, does not mean that they will not come back. And invasives, we all know, is never one and done. So that's the issue that we have. We fund them now, and then who funds them in future years?
Like I said, I like the project, and if we can resolve what the ultimate use of this land is going to be, whether it's for farming or whether it's as maintained as grassland, would be helpful. But I, you know, the application itself says we understand that this is the first stage of an ongoing project. It kind of goes into detail. You know, essentially, they're not sure exactly how they're going to maintain it yet, but there are a bunch of different options. And I feel that, coupled with the fact that I recognize the report, it would be great to get the report and read the report, but CONCOM hasn't weighed in on what it is going to do with the private individuals, private entities' recommendations. And so I don't have a problem with where funding is under the stewardship. I feel like that's part and parcel of what CPA funds can be used for. I just think it needs to be, we should have that discussion first instead of letting this one go. That's always a slippery slope. But have that discussion either with CONCOM or with Wayne, or have that collectively say, what is the best way for us to do this so that we don't have every round we have four invasive species things that total $60,000 or whatever we have. And do we give you a budget to work with once we understand what your prioritization scheme is? But I'm also sensitive to Kevin's point that it might take a few meetings for you to get there, and if they can make a convincing case now that there's a reason why this is a priority, we do that. But I'd rather do that as part of the regular planning round so we have an open dialogue as opposed to make the decision and have the discussion afterwards.
Like I said, if I thought there was not a fall demand that made particular sense, I would go with that. But it seems like to me the horse is out of the barn. We've been funding invasive species projects every round. And so I think we agree. We keep buying more land, that's a good thing. But the functionality of the coalitions that take care of it seems to be, it doesn't seem to be enough, or we wouldn't be getting these. And so I think there is a larger conversation, I absolutely do. And I think Sanders' report is the first start to it. I just admit that I think it takes some time to get from there to here's an action plan.
So we have the option with the small grants to kick the can down the road, correct? And to put this into the larger thing. Do we have the option to put it off until next meeting, and get questions to, in this case, Wayne, and then revisit it as a small grant? Is that, did, I'm looking to you, is that?
Can, that wasn't our expectation. Our expectation is that we would make a decision during this meeting so that it doesn't get dragged on and it's separate from the rest of the process. The language, sorry, the language that we have says, small grants to consider at the initial meeting starting funding round. Committee reserves the right to deny a request for small grant funding should the nature of the project or question raised in response warrant fuller consideration to the traditional funding round. Having to notify this, in this case, to gauge their desire to further participate in the funding round.
I'd also like that. I think whatever we do with this one's more different than the other, and they don't seem different to me.
Although the other one is not city-owned property. City
I agree,
has a secret.
It's conservation restriction.
I feel like, first off, I think all the comments tonight have been very insightful, and I find myself agreeing with most of them. I also think, though, that these are very small grants. They're for clearly worthy causes, and I have this sneaking feeling that we're sort of moving the goalposts a little bit downfield, because our concern about having a larger dialogue about where maintenance for these newly acquired lands is going to come from is a legitimate interest, but if that's the case, we should have not accepted this kind of this kind of request for agreement. So I don't think we should fund any more of them until we know what the overall plan is. But I would feel comfortable voting on these two tonight.
Can I just respond in terms of the goalposts? I feel like we had that discussion when we approved $30,000 for the original plan, where there was an additional $30,000 or $40,000 requested for implementation. And we said, we don't feel comfortable giving you money to prioritize these things without first looking at the plan and hearing the feedback that the contract. So, and you know, when you had an opportunity to include the full report to explain it in the context of this larger decision, provide any additional information of why it's needed absolutely now, why this is the highest priority, it's not there. But I mean, that's what the process was there for, to give us the essential information. It was not needed in this process. My concern, in addition to not knowing what the plan is that if we do this now and we say yes, just going to encourage more of that, and we won't have the discussion. We will have the discussion, but it won't matter if we have set the precedent. But it sounds like everyone agrees that the project itself is worthy. It's just a matter of how it's raised in the context of the previous.
And I think everyone agrees with your point too about the need for ongoing discussion.
So I think I appreciate the historical context that you put it in, because that certainly didn't come to mind for me, and I don't know about it. So that, you know, and you've said it twice now. So that's, I think, really helpful. And so I think part of what I hear Devin saying is that there's going to be this bumping learning curve as we tweak this out with these $3,000 asks. But I think you just reiterated that there was another ask, and that this committee responded that they need more information before they're going to give again, and this is coming nonetheless. So I'm comfortable voting on both of these tonight, but I will just put it out there that in that context, that I would want to move this to the larger funding round and just make that point so that future things come in that way, because we know that more will come from this source, from this avenue. So
we
could be on the right
page for that. I think there is a difference between the two projects too, that they're both small projects and they're both having to do with invasives, but I was very interested to see the Lathrop proposal, because it's some people taking initiative and trying to be part of the system, and it's abutting conservation land, and it, you know, it has an added benefit for the recreational use of a very wonderful segment of our population. So I think it's a little different than the Conservation Commission's program of dealing with public lands. So it did have a different flavor to me than that.
Then I just want to talk to the three about the $3,000 limit. We put that on ourselves. We voted on that. And I don't think we should be all surprised if we get a number of applicants who reach for that number. And it's, I mean, why wouldn't most applicants, unless it was a truly very, very limited project. But if we put the limit of $3,000 on, and as a result, people develop projects that they are going to, you know, do $3,000 worth of, because of the limit we put on, I don't think we should then say, oh, well, everybody's trying to push the limits here. And that's to be expected that somebody would try to have as large a project as they could within the kind of the regulations that we set up for ourselves. If we don't like that, then we should set a lower limit. Unless we have some sense that somebody's doing something useless with that, you know, that it's really a $2,000 project that they're inflating to three, or whether it's somehow it's an incremental creep and they're doing $3,000 on a $9,000 project, which I haven't mentioned earlier, which would be very inefficient. But unless we see something wrong with it, I have no problem with the number. I mean, God bless them, that we set the number and they're going for it.
I think it wasn't clear in my...
I wasn't criticizing you at all.
Comment. I think there was a concern on the part of the committee that these really be discrete projects and that they really be small projects,
yeah,
not a portion of a larger project.
I agree.
So I was really raising the question of, is this a portion of a larger project that is segmented to fit, and therefore are we really getting what we wanted, or... So
yeah.
That was
the reason. That's what it takes for them to do it. Right, and a skilled grant writer will make it work.
Right.
They'll give you a $6,000 budget or less.
Yes,
that's what it looks like, yeah.
Well, I mean, I'm reading that it's made up of resident donations.
Well,
that's...
Are we skipping ahead to last?
I'm sorry, you're still in general fund.
Yeah. No, we are not, but...
We're not going to go ahead to the next one.
No,
I'm sorry. My bad.
So another process question. So if we were to vote this down, put it into the general category, and then Sarah conveyed this to Wayne, who said, oh my goodness, it has to be, we really want it to be done now. Do we have the option then to revisit it again? Or once we make this decision, it's into the queue and we have to wait until December?
And we hadn't envisioned that, I guess, but it's something the committee could think about if that came up. I don't think that's the case. I think Wayne was expecting to do this in the spring.
In the spring.
I believe so.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not an expedited, it's just, oh, this is a small application.
I think we ought to give ourselves a little license to work with this procedure here and turn ourselves into knots. I suggest submitting some. I know it's not the procedure we wanted, but we're learning. Submitting the question to Wayne and inviting him to either respond in writing or take another night out of his life and come to the next meeting and then go to that content. We'll need to be satisfied that it fits within the small grant criteria and that we have enough information, or we'll keep it in the foreground. But the unfortunate thing is we just don't have enough information to go on, and it may be that we really should just move ahead with it. We can just get the answer to a couple of questions. We can take informed action.
Yeah, we can take informed action on that in the regular round, Chad's question and answers. And that was the process that you laid out. I understand.
Sure.
We don't really get them, but
right.
We have to write the questions. We have to spend the time sending the questions over. At the same time, we've got new stuff that we're supposed to be doing. I just assume road and do it all together. I mean, this is one applicant who has the wherewithal to write a good application and include all the information that we need. If we have outstanding concerns on the ground there, then it's there.
But the other proposal could be voted on, right, later?
Correct. Right now, we're just looking at the shrubland restoration.
And so again, in the context of this being new, this process being new, it may be that we actually want applicants to come when we're considering it, because that would deal with some of this question asking that we would have, and they couldn't answer them, and we would be able to get here. But if they knew they were coming, and we would ask things.
I do suspect that if Wayne had a critical timing issue,
yeah,
he certainly would have mentioned that. I think he was expecting this to be funded along with the rest of the, if it were to be funded at all.
Any other discussion? So the question on the table was to appropriate $3,000 to the Mineral Hill invasive removal and shrubland restoration. Are we good to vote?
Yes. Motion to vote, yeah.
Motion to vote?
Yeah.
All in favor? All opposed? Abstaining?
I'm not voting.
He's not legal.
Official.
Oh, you're not legal?
I'm not legal yet until the city council votes.
Is Donald Trump president?
So we're missing.
3-3, right?
So that fails.
So that fails. Correct.
So then what's the default? Yes.
The default is it's kicked up, we're kicking it up. Is that correct? Is that the default?
No, we need a new motion because it could just be denied altogether. Because we can say no to one.
I move we consider the Mineral Hills invasive project for the full round.
Is there a second?
Could you repeat the motion?
I move we consider this project for the full round.
Okay. Since it is in limbo right now. Okay.
Yes.
Second, yeah.
Linda, I think Linda seconded already.
Third.
Discussion?
I'm wondering, what seems to me to be the heart of what we've just said is that we really like we're actually wanting the city to provide us something by way of guidance for future spending on stewardship. So we've gotten Sanders' review, and that needs to get turned into an action plan. But I don't know how this committee asks the city to do that. I mean, we can just make the statement, would you please? But I mean, it's not we could do what Dave's suggesting, which is let's dig our heels in until we see some plan for the future. But I have not, I don't know how to do that. The request of
I'm not plan. Sure that's a fair characterization of what I said. I do think that that's something that the CONCOM eventually will need to do with this report, and it's one of our expectations coming out of our money.
But I do think
the CONCOM can look at parcels that it has and look at the report and give us a prioritization based on its read, without making votes about the grand structure of all of our lands, to say, here's what we expect to see in the future. And then we have a larger discussion about, is that piecemeal, is it collective, if you come in with one proposal or many proposals, we do it that way.
Yeah.
I think that's a legitimate ask, and I imagine that's something they're going to want to do anyway.
Well, I think we hinted at it, but my point is, I think that process will take some definite amount of time. I mean, I wouldn't expect them to maybe have that for a year.
Right. But I do think if we ask questions, which we will of all applicants, we can say one of our hesitations in granting it as a small grant is we don't know in the context of this larger plan why this is prioritized. A new acquisition from 2012, we have lots of other acquisitions that have other invasive species. Why was this the priority this time? And be prepared to have a discussion when you come before us about how we're going to deal with this in a more holistic way, procedurally and from an ecological perspective.
Can I comment? I think that especially for those of you who are conservation oriented, I have no problem with CPA money going for stewardship because we are obviously committed to open space. On the other hand, we have limited funds, and so money that goes to stewardship is not going to be able to go for acquisition. And the more acquisition we have, I mean, the more once that occurs, it means that more stewardship is going to have to occur. And there's eventually a tipping point where we're not going to really acquire anything because we're putting all the money into stewardship if we're doing things right. So it's all good as far as I'm concerned, but there are trade-offs. And so if the city gobbles up vastly more land, not gobbles up, but conserves and protects, but you know what I mean, then somebody's got to take care of it. And there needs to be budgeting for that because it would probably mean that we would be no longer available as an acquisition funding source because we'd be spending all of our money on taking care of the land that's been acquired. So it's just, but again, that judgment issue is probably best determined by the Conservation Commission.
Additional discussion? So the question on the table is to bump this up to the general rep, correct?
Yeah.
However we phrase that. Sarah, you got that right?
Yeah.
All in favor? All opposed? So unanimous. When are you leaving, Jack?
As soon as the city council votes.
So perhaps next meeting.
I know that they referred it out to appointments and ordinances committee. So then they'll bounce it back to city council. Hopefully, reading.
Well, thanks for being here and contributing to the discussion. So the second small grant application is the Lathrop community removing invasives on a conservation restricted land. So it's private land, it's Lathrop land, but the city holds a CR on it. Is there a motion on the floor, Dave?
Well, I move to approve, but I have a comment on conditions.
So let's first do the move.
Move to approve.
How much?
Hmm?
How much money?
Oh, $3,000.
$3,000. Is there a second?
Second.
Linda seconds. Discussion.
Discussion. First off, I'm very impressed with the level of contribution that the community is putting into it. I think that's a very good sign. 50% is very nice. I mean, that came out of somebody's pockets, and that's a very good thing. It's a fabulous community. That also adds to its asset. There are a lot of people in the community, and that adds to its asset. I'm concerned about the principle of accessibility, and because in we turned down stairways onto a jail because only an X number of residents occupied the building, the conversion. This is a much smaller amount of money and a much larger number of residents, but it remains a private piece of property. So I would want to make sure that in principle we're putting city money into private utilization. I would want to see that some condition that there could be public access to the trails. I don't think it's going to result in any overuse or gross misuse of the trails, but we are stewards of public trust here and money. And if we fund a private nonprofit private area, we would have to figure out how we would turn down the next private applicant. I'm very open-minded about it, but I just encourage you that was an issue.
I took a different thought on it. Because it's conservation restricted land, I don't think it's their land, I don't think it's private land. They have a high likelihood of using it, and they have a trail that they put through it, but I think of it as public land.
I certainly have used it frequently myself.
I'm sorry. I thought it was their land.
They label it as a public.
Sarah, land. Can you clarify that? If there's a CR restriction, does it mean?
It can. It doesn't usually. Having a conservation restriction on a property doesn't guarantee public access. It prohibits a lot of different types of activity. Yeah. So they couldn't ever build on it. And that restriction is held by the city, and we would do the enforcement, but then no way to guarantee public access. This one may allow it, I don't think it does. But
I mean, there's a lot of farm fields that are agricultural,
yeah, I think
farm
right.
fields, but
yeah.
They're still private fields. And And I think that's the same situation here. Again, I would love to fund this. I'm totally in favor of the project, but we have to be able to respond to any member of the public who says, how come you're funding a thing on private land?
I think they at least, whether they're obligated to or not, and we can make that a condition, they seem to be assuming that there is, because they talk about trail provide recreation for Lathrop residents and the public.
As long as they're understanding, yeah.
So I think that's the intention.
So if we put that in condition, the trail will be, not claiming any right of way on it, but the trail, they will maintain the trail, be open to the public. I think that would help us respond to anybody who, brought this issue up to us. That it is public accessible.
Linda, you've hiked on this trail?
And skied on it.
And you're allowed to park there in Lathrop, like where the trail heads?
No, I park by Cook Avenue and go in, and the trail goes off very shortly after you start in on the Bottom Meadow Road.
So you're not parking on their property?
No.
Is it legal to park on their property to access?
Is it legal to what?
Park on their property to access the trail?
I don't know, but there is parking area reserved on Cook Avenue to park so that you can go on Bottom Meadow Road.
So that conservation restriction in no way guarantees public access. They may choose to allow it. If they stop doing that would not be a violation of the restriction.
I think the trail maps for Fitzgerald Conservation Area include that loop too, so they're publicly disseminating information about the trail system, so I think they're trying to encourage public use.
I think we just reinforce that with this. It's a good thing to say that's the reason we recognize it, and I think that will get around your concern.
Yeah, I mean,
about being consistent for projects.
We can say the public could be having access, and we also emphasize that it abuts Fitzgerald Lake, and as a result, if we don't reduce invasives there, then it's going to spread back into Fitzgerald Lake, and so it's sort of like a catchment area. It makes it efficient. I want to fund this. I have no objection to it at all, but I just, precedent is important.
Yeah, I don't see an issue with the included condition that says, as stipulated in the letter of the conservation, public has used and will be able to continue to use the trail. They don't want to accept that.
In discussing the proposal, if there's a condition you feel strongly on, do you put that on now, or do we vote before, or do we amend the motion to put a condition on it? How do we do that?
In the past, you discussed what our conditions may be, and in this latest round, we added them into the motion, but we haven't always included them in our resolution when we made the contract or whatever. But I think if that's something that we're reaching out, it would be worthwhile amending the motion.
I'm guessing that the Lathrop community's attorneys may have a problem guaranteeing public access forever for $3,000.
We don't.
So they're asking for a 3-year cycle. So I think we would say for the duration of the funding from this project. So that would be 3 years.
Wisdom of Solomon, I love it.
Yeah.
Or at least that long.
Yeah, I think we've made the point, and I think we're all pretty confident that it's in actuality being used that way, so.
Have we ever done something like this on private land?
We have not, but we've never been asked either.
So this is our first time acting on private land at all, is that? Lathrop a non-profit? We've done non-profit stuff. Lathrop is a non-profit.
For an open space project? Yes, we have done, we've provided acquisition funds for open space projects that have some limited amount of public access, a certain number of times per year.
for example, but this is the first.
Actually, the Start Northampton is a nonprofit, private nonprofit.
Well, I mean, yeah.
So we have given money to do it.
Yes.
And we funded the purchase of conservation district that don't guarantee unlimited public access.
So are we, who made the motion? So I'm confused, are we looking for an amended motion to put in that?
I would make the motion, restate the motion as the originator of it, that we approve the funding of the project to the global $3,000 with the proviso that the trails through the affected area remain accessible to the public during the duration of the, during the term of the grant. And that was it.
Not less than the duration.
No less than the duration of the grant.
Sarah, did you get that?
Mm-hmm.
And do we need now a second on that?
Second.
We haven't amended.
Or Linda second, of course, I'll be second.
And further discussion?
I'm not entirely clear on the 3-year cycle. So they're going to use some of the funds until they've used all of the funds over a 3-year period. Is that what it's
saying? Right, the herbicide treatments and the cutting require you to go back
multiple
years, so they won't burn out all of the, and I mean, the only way they would burn out all the funds is if they apply CPA funds the first year and then use their. So that's possible. Yeah. We can stipulate that it's the 3-year cycle through which they buy it to give us the choice.
I don't know how many situations like this we have, but in light of our earlier discussion, this is exactly what we want to have happen. We want involvement with people taking over the stewardship of the land.
Yeah, okay. I'll say it. I feel like there's some, as Jack pointed out, there's some contrast between these two applications. One is there's a tremendous amount of public support that goes along with it by way of not only the ecological restoration folks who submitted, but members, partners, folks who worked with it. We got the contribution of econ, people's topics. The fact that the community is involved in their own lands, that would set a part of the solution. And this is.
I'm not seeing where we came up with 3 years. I'm reading the proposal from Fullerton, is that how you say? Associates, and it's like there's no page numbers, but at the end of their proposal, they have the 2 years, 2016 and 2017. It's three tasks, but it's over 2 years.
I'm looking at page 4 of their sort of application, and it's number 8 explaining the various steps of the project. But I wasn't clear on this. I'm not saying that's the earliest 3 years, and maybe that's it. But the CPA funds would be used.
And that's also number 1 of page 3. It says over 3 years for contractor or invasive species.
Additional discussion? All in favor of the proposal? All opposed? So unanimously approved.
Our first small round.
Yay!
And wouldn't it be terrible not to have any of this round?
That's good. All right, so just for me to check in, so this is going to City Council second, as you called out in the application. So I'll put together a council resolution for the next meeting. And if that's approved, I'll take it to the next meeting.
Correct. And you will also notify Wayne that we kicked his down the road.
Okay.
With the first. Hooray for us.
Can we just knock the rest of these out tonight?
Why not? All in favor of knocking the rest of these? Okay, so moving right along. Memorandums of understanding for our round one 2015 projects. Sarah, do you have, are you able to put that up?
So I emailed those out and I tried really hard to make this terrible graphic work, but it doesn't work.
And once again, haven't we expressed our displeasure for years of the state of technology?
Yes, and I will do it again after this actual one right now.
So how do you suggest we proceed?
So these are, I sent these out twice, and people didn't have a lot of time to look at them last time, so this was kind of a refresher, and I sent them out this time. So I guess just go one more room and see if you have concerns, if anybody, people have had a chance to look at them.
Okay, can you lead us through which one by one is?
Conservation fund. So that was $20,000 to the conservation fund, and this particular MOU was exactly the same as the previous ones for the conservation fund. So it required that all land acquisitions using CPA funds must be protected with conservation or APRs, and then have to be executed within 6 months after a purchase, and that the CPA has approval that it can over 20.
So how are we proceeding on this? Do we vote for each one? Or do we, can we accept them, put them all in the one big package?
Or either way.
How about a package, is that okay?
Why don't, there may be some little tweaks, so why don't we discuss them one by one?
Okay.
So that we can.
So do we need a motion to accept this as a confirmed MOU? How do we do this? Someone help me out, forget my.
So it would be a motion to approve as presented.
So, is there a motion to approve the CONSCOM fund as accepted?
Yes.
Okay, Linda is the motion. Dave seconds. Discussion?
The only thing I would point out is that you've got hard costs under 20,000, hard costs over 20,000, and something exactly 20,000, you don't know what to do. So.
You're tough.
All right. Shall I change the second one to 20,001?
To up to 20,000. The other one can be over 20,000.
Okay. So I'm changing under to up to.
Yep.
Any other discussion? Okay, vote to all those in favor of the motion. Opposed? Unanimous. Second one, Sarah?
So the next one is Fitzgerald Lake Conservation Area Open Space. So this was $30,000 for a land acquisition, and the special conditions were that it has to be protected with a CR held by a third party. Permanent sign shall be installed within 6 months of, 3 months of acquiring title, and that the CONSCOM shall sponsor a zoning change to farms, forests, and rivers, which is the city's most restrictive district.
Is there a motion to approve as whatever the word was?
Yes.
Second.
And motion, Dave second, discussion?
It's just a typo. It says 30,200 on the first page.
Oh.
You did a great job having read these on our behalf. Thank you. Any other discussion? David? Oh, okay. So we made the motion. We have seconded. All those in favor? Opposed? Unanimous. Next.
The next one, this is a big amount for an MOU, but it's a city department. So it's $1,450,000 for Pulaski Park. Special conditions were CPA awareness, so that the DPW has to let everybody know that the CPA paid for it. And CPA funds shall not be spent on the purchase, transportation, or planting of an 18 to 22 foot replacement evergreen tree.
Is there a motion to accept that? Linda, you're on a roll. Dave, you're on a second roll. Should we revisit the tree issue for the next 2 hours?
That's in the council.
We can do that. We can do that.
And have thoughts.
And have. Is that a no? Is there a discussion on this?
It's really a question I should have raised it before. Why is, I know this is between the city and the city, essentially, but I thought when it's a contract, the CPA members sign.
It's not a contract.
I know, it's an MOU, so, so what's the thinking?
We were notified by the auditors that we are the only committee that was still signing these after the charter change. I guess that brought it up for everybody, so it's not necessary that the CPA.
Okay.
So we'll never sign the way we used to sign.
If you really, really want to, I can include the signature page, but it's in no way necessary.
Is that both for contracts?
Yeah.
Okay. Actually, that feels right. And then there's just another typo. There's another comment. I don't
know. Is that anything else?
That's it.
Further discussion?
I'd just like to clarify that I'm looking at them on my phone and I'm not doing other things.
What are they thanking for saying?
Texting is evil. Dan, were you going to say something? Sure, can you say something? Further discussion on this one? All those in favor? Opposed? Unanimous. Next.
And the last one is the September clock. So that was $3,000 for purchase and moving. Now it was moving and securing a few critical pieces to the Seth Thomas clock.
The clock that never ends. Oh my God. This is good.
Same conditions regarding CPA awareness, and the clock shall ultimately be installed in a highly visible public downtown location. And some sort of restriction will be placed on the clock so it won't be sold or destroyed without city council approval.
Is there a motion? Hey. Whoa, shaking it up. Just a second. Discussion. In the absence of, all those in favor? Opposed? Unanimous. Is that it?
That's it.
Ooh, rough.
You're like Tip O'Neill.
My predecessor has been here, we'd still be on the public comment.
I'm not criticizing.
I'm stating facts. Moving right along to review our schedule, which will be challenging in the absence of audiovisual aid.
So I've sent this out as well a couple times just so everybody has it. So the next big thing for everyone to know is that committee members' questions for applicants are due to me by 4 p.m. on September 28th. I will put those together immediately and send them to applicants. Our next meeting is October 7th, which will be the first meeting with applicants, followed by another one of those on October 14th. Public comments.
October 7th?
Yeah, so our next two meetings, October 7th and the 14th. It seems like we'll probably need both. We used to try and do it all in one meeting, but that can be for really one meeting. Public comment session October 21st, and then recommendations and council orders to follow. And
my
the
goodness,
one thing
we, three, we have 3 Wednesdays in a row, so.
By the way, can I mention something to the chair? October 6th, you should be invited, and Sarah, maybe you can make sure Smith knows about it. There's a breakfast at Smith from 8 to 9:30, to which you're invited, most of the committee or commission chairs. It's not because I'm a good person, but because I chair the historical commission, that I'm invited annually, and you certainly should be because of your position now.
Thank you. I was
calling, and you get to. The mayor will be there, and the president of the Smith College, and a variety of other worthies and nobles.
Jack, just for your information, so on the September the 28th, if as you are reviewing proposals and you have questions, you can write them down and then send them by email to Sarah, who will then send them along to the candidates so that they have thought about your questions before they appear in person on those days to answer them. So it just makes things run a little quicker if they have some of our questions in advance.
And they provide written answers as well.
So we all might ask the same question.
Correct.
Independently.
But yes.
I'll edit them. I'm almost sure. And then the one date to be determined is site visits if needed, and we always reserve this to the date that works best for everybody for only the projects that seem to require it. So that is definitely a question.
Can you at least do me a favor and send that out one more time?
Yes.
To us. But do people have objections or questions about those dates?
Just so we just should figure out site visits.
And those would be sometime after the 21st, is that correct?
Not necessarily. Whatever works best for people. We've done afternoons, we've done Saturdays. I don't know how many of these people deal with those group visits.
So Jack, once again, for your information, we have reserved certain times to go and visit sites. Not everyone goes, sometimes very few people go. It's not a Wednesday evening thing, but like going to Historic Northampton to look at the houses and look at some of the issues that they are having in terms of their building deterioration and stuff. You would find that helpful. Finding a date or a Saturday when we can all go is next to impossible, but we do the best that we can. Would someone like to propose a date? Sir, any time in October, is that right? Or
whatever works.
From now on.
Before questions, after questions, it's a little bit different everywhere.
Traditionally, we have done it on Saturday mornings, is that correct?
Some mornings or afternoons. I think a few times we've done. We've let the applicants know that they will need to be available. Generally hasn't been an issue.
For myself, Saturday, September 26th looks good. I'm not going to be available. It's probably any weekend in October.
How would the 26th work for folks? That is less than 2 weeks, right? Mm-hmm. Week and a half?
My daughter's on a writing team, and so I'm new to what happens with the shows, so they're in a show that day. I'll probably know more after this weekend, which is unfortunate. So there's shows pretty much every weekend except for October 17th and 24th. I know the morning probably isn't good, so possibly the afternoon that day, but I can't 100% commit.
Anybody else?
I can probably do the 26th, but I can also do the 3rd and 10th.
So the 26th, the 3rd, the 10th. Anybody?
I can do this. I think the issue is short notice since here Sarah can get it put together by next Saturday. If she can, the sooner the better, the time will help us in our discussion.
It depends on which ones people want to go through.
Yeah, there's not a chance that we get the full committee calendar lined up. So.
We want to discuss where we would go. Historic Northampton, yes? Seems logical, correct?
Yeah.
Do we need to go back to Pulaski?
Nope.
No.
Not much to see.
I'm
walking in every day. There's not much going on.
Take a look at the curtains at the Academy and see that cool scenic curtain, yes? That could be fine. The boathouse parking area?
That, if people just want to check that out, that's open during business hours, so you can just drive in.
And we're looking pretty much paving and the gate, right? That's it?
Putting a top coat and something there.
Yeah. The clock.
Good picture of it.
Yeah, no, no need for the clock. The Rocky Hill connector?
Yeah.
It's a hike. I walked it. I don't know that you're really.
Would people be interested in that? Dave, I know you've always been interested.
Is this adjacent to the one that we just purchased? I don't know that I need you, but if we're gonna ask them to do it, then I'll go. I know where the property is, but I'm not on the property.
And you would be interested in going? Okay, so put that down. The bridge over Bob. Fitzgerald Lake, looking at the dock and the boardwalk.
I have a question about this. Is this gonna maintain or hopefully even improve accessibility?
Yes.
We could do that ourselves, but.
I've seen it.
Yeah, I think that's an individual.
That's an individual one? So what do we have? We've got the Rocky Hill Conservation Area, the Academy of Music, and Historic Northampton, is that it?
Yeah.
So we have three ones and we're still talking about a date, correct?
So just give me the date that works best for everybody, because last year nobody.
Do we wanna sleep on this and get back to Sarah? Would that be helpful?
I can, what were the three dates that worked best? I can send out a little poll.
I suppose the 26th, the.
Third and the 10th.
Third and 10th.
And I would request that you schedule the Rocky Hill connector not in the middle of the story, either earlier or at the end of.
Anything else about the round two schedule that we need to discuss? So Sarah will send up those dates again and a little poll to query us about site visitations. Yes, good to go. So last but not least, review the CPA plan. How are we to proceed on that?
So this could end up being sort of a rolling target for this round. I've received a lot of comments very recently, so I haven't sent them out to everyone yet. So maybe just continue with this for a second if you haven't done so. And I'll send out tomorrow all the revisions that I've gotten. We do need to have a public hearing at some point. It doesn't have to be during the budget.
So you're getting public comments?
No.
Where are you getting comments?
So comments from applicable boards, the Historic Commission, CONSCOM, and Housing Partnership and Housing Authority, right? Or yeah. Were those your comments?
I don't know, is that your comments?
I just gave them. I think Peg Keller did those.
Okay, so Housing Partnership, scattered from boards.
So I just gave the most recent draft to the Housing Partnership on Monday, which was our meeting. So because we can't, because we're under high scrutiny right now, so pretty much our plan is to have it on the agenda for our October 14th okay. meeting, with people giving the comments back to me to get to you.
Sarah, I was looking over the open space section, as I was asked to do, and noticed that it has not been updated. Oh, I didn't see that you had sent something out with sort of updated statistics. Is that forthcoming?
So the versions that I sent out were, I started with my edits just to make them sure. It should have included that.
I did not see that in this last. But maybe I just screwed it up.
Yes, there's not a lot.
there's just a few. I'll send it again and make sure that the changes are really visible. But there were only a few.
Great.
Are we able to entertain new business on an agenda that does not call for it?
It depends on what it is. If it's,
if
you can bring it up, and if you think it's really significant and should be listed as a separate agenda item, we can process it.
It'll be bounced next time anyway, but having received the applications, I wanted to renew a discussion that we started to have since we're now under a different leadership about possibly putting some kind of limitations on the length of the applications to force people to really focus their applications and distill the information. I think one application in particular requires altogether too much work to really try to do that.
Are we allowed to discuss this now? And that was not on the agenda?
I think it's great to have placed the comment out there and that we will be in discussion next week and we should, on the next meeting, and we should put it on that one.
Great.
Thank you for it. I would like to agree.
And if I could add, not only the length of the written proposal, but do we want to discuss the length of the presentation as well? Because I think I struggled with that last time.
Actually, that would be a good one to have now, just because the presentations will be next week and the meeting after. So, and that's kind of just an informal thing that we do anyway. So,
may I make a comment? A brief comment. A lot of the length of the presentation have been due to the applicant responding to questions from the board. And so rather than lengthy monologues, oftentimes they have been simply responses to a lot of questions that we have generated. So we should look to ourselves too for brevity if brevity is needed.
Maybe we could time the presentation and then open it for questions from, you know, our questions. So if we...
So unlimited questions, but limited...
Yeah, if it warrants more questions, we will come up with the questions, I'm sure.
Just to guide applicants, 5 minutes for presentations? More?
I would allow...
Five
myself, I would allow 10, because some are more complicated than others.
So not more than 10.
Well, the issue is, like when we were doing Pulaski Park, we could not do that in 10. Like, we really could, we could not justify, we had to have longer.
No, just the presentation from applicants. And then we actually decided to have a whole separate meeting about Pulaski Park, which was a little bit outside of that process.
Okay, so that was a special
thing. To me, it's not a matter of necessarily, there have been times when we've had people who've gone on at length. And part of it is the meter, part of it is the tone and the inflection makes it seem longer than it needs to be. But I think maybe the caution to give them is to not spend time rehashing all the information that's in the application, but to focus on critical parts and anticipate the types of questions you may be asking and try to put those questions out there. So I guess maybe the other way to say is assume that you've read the application. Things unnecessarily.
I think we should do that, and I think there should be some time engagement because I think both are necessary.
Can we do something?
I think we're forgetting that we know the project, but I think they need to summarize the project in a very succinct way so that the public has an appreciation of the project. But at 10 minutes, that would be 80 minutes for our next round before we would ever ask the first question. So a 5-minute summary. I had been thinking 10 like you, but I think if we set a 5-minute summary, just so that the public knows which one we're talking about, and you assume that we have read your project, we looked at the spreadsheets and the pictures and that sort of thing, that might be the right instruction to give them.
We've had some fabulous applications from groups that could not possibly have fit within the time frame and a large, I mean, not just Pulaski Park, but Florence Fields. The think of the lovely presentation by the school children, little school children.
That's public comment.
That's what?
That's public comment. We don't.
Okay, great. As long as we can accommodate the published comments in support, then I certainly don't want to squelch any comments like that.
And again, I think we've got some flexibility, so we can certainly say unless otherwise indicated.
Yeah, I think that's a very good solution. If we public comment shouldn't be limited, except by, you know, the chair's decision if somebody's running on too long. But so I certainly want to make us available to any groundswell of popularity for what you haven't seen. We've had kids in Cub Scout uniforms. We've had kids in Little League uniforms and half of Jackson Street School.
I'm drawing the line of puppies.
In here, and there's no way we want to stop that. It's just wonderful. So
we're not going to try to do all these in one night, though.
Two nights.
It's a lot. It's a slug for those two meetings. I'd be wrong if I didn't tell you.
And the applicants will also have seen all of your questions by then, so they'll probably have some idea of ways that they should share with the presentation to best address them.
I think that's the key to it, is they'll know what our questions are, and if they were wise, they'd use most of their time to direct to our questions.
Although, again, they will have answered our written questions before we see them in October. So we will have read their written responses to our written questions as Sarah has presented to them.
Well, it seems, and I think I like Linda's approach, is to emphasize we're talking about their presentation, their oral presentation to us, to be ideally limited to a certain amount of time unless the chair decides that no time is warranted, to be followed by questions from us.
And that time is what? I've heard 5 minutes, 10 minutes?
5 to 10.
Are we good with that?
I like 10 to 15. I just, sometimes there are slides and, you know.
Well, I think I don't want to come off as the committee's time is so valuable. That, I mean, I'm amazed people come to the meeting, and if they come, I think we ought to hear them. So certainly on public comment, I think that's good reason to let that go for any amount of time it's needed. The applicants, they vary. I mean, some think that the more time they have, the more convincing they can be, and I'm not sure that really, that's almost counterproductive sometimes.
So is the purpose of them presenting really what you said, to get it out there and set the stage for the conversation and the public comment that will follow? Because there has been a lot of, we've applied, we've received questions, we've responded to questions. So, I mean, sometimes people do better with non-written presentations, but they kind of have to jump this hurdle with us in the first place. And, you know, our time actually is kind of important. I agree that it can go on and on, and I'm not sure. A number of years ago, I and some other people in a capacity of thinking about approaching this committee met with a committee member who said, not in these words, we want a dog and pony show. And we really felt intimidated by that. Like, really? Like, we have to come, like, really, and wow you with our technological ability, and, you know, so I, you know, that may have been a flavor of that time, but I'm just not sure what, you know, if it's just to lay the groundwork of, here we are now, and now everybody knows what we're talking about, and here we go, then I don't know how much time they really need, because, you know, we've all, by then, spent a lot of time on their application, so I don't know. I'm just not
in my experience, mostly it's been question and answer and dialogue between applicant and the committee. So not so much rehashing what the committee's already seen, but going over new things and questions that haven't been answered yet.
Under new leadership, I trust we won't be here after 11.
The Red Sox aren't in there. So I've heard 5 to 10, then 10 to 15. Do we want to pass on to applicants one of those two, or 5 to 15, what
What does it say?
Let me see.
5 to 10 minutes, and then if, again, if my feeling is we're here to serve the public, not to serve our own schedule, and it is a trust that we hold. And if occasionally we need to sit and go later than 9, God knows the city council goes to 11 or 12 at night, and I don't want to do that very often. But if somebody's pouring their heart out for an application, I feel the obligation to sit and listen and show them that respect. But let's say for the core presentation, I need to focus their mind if we say 5 to 10. And then if we have a lot of questions, then we have a lot of questions, and I'll sit and listen to as long as my colleagues want to ask questions, because that's good stuff. So, but let's focus their mind and say, 5 to 10. Is that okay?
Dave, you're good with that?
Yes.
Okay. Sarah, the one thing that I found really awkward, was it last funding cycle, the one before that, was when one of the candidates came in with an audio, that had worked very hard on an audio visual thing, we had no computer up. So I don't know, we struggled with this, Jack, forever, just for Sarah.
It's every committee that works.
Every committee that works. It's friggin' technology, doesn't, sometimes it works. So I don't know if you'll know in advance, but you can say, come in prepared to have no technology, because
yeah,
we don't want someone spending hours.
We have another projector. I can bring it down from the planning office, but it's very awkward to have it on the desk. It doesn't work.
Yeah.
Can we consider, we've done this in the past between Sarah and Downey, but maybe at this point, since it continues to malfunction like it did tonight, can we have a letter from the chair signed by all of us to go to the mayor's office and whoever's responsible for
The bigger overlying issue is there are bigger plans for this room, and it's been a varying time frame about what exactly it's going to be. I think they're TVs or something, but very reluctant to fix this.
But they need to, meetings.
I need to.
The more people who say something, whatever shows, the more likely it's going to be fixed.
All right, so I'm happy to bring something that we can pass around and have signed it next meeting, yes? Okay, letter expressing our disgust, our rage.
Mr. Chairman,
I'm on a roll here.
I'll send you an email drafting that for your consideration, you will? If you would like.
Oh, you're so wonderful. You're much better worded than mine.
When you started writing, I thought we needed a little F word insert and, there.
Without using the F word in memos to the mayor, is that? No, Devin would do a better job.
But I think it should come out under your signature, but I would be happy to start it.
So, but I would need direction. If the 10 minutes, they're on a roll, and the certain candidates may be, then everyone look at me, and I'll say thank you, and we're going to move on to questions.
Yeah.
But I don't want to make that call. I don't think it's appropriate for me to say it's 10 minutes, you're done, unless you think I should play timekeeper. I'm happy to do it.
Yeah, and it's a good point about the technology, too. Maybe I should just tell people don't do a PowerPoint. Bring in a few visual aids if you think it's really going to help. I don't know how to get around this issue.
I think Brian's suggestion is a good one, saying feel free to go to PowerPoint, recognizing that our technology is
may not work.
Right, and so you may want to bring a printout to share with the community.
One alternative to that, and I don't want to encourage them, but if they could send a presentation and start to distribute it to us, which is one way to go, if they just really think that they're being strapped. So there is one way around it.
I would favor having, if somebody wants to do like a PowerPoint that can be sent to us in advance so we can watch it ourselves, rather than doing like a half hour PowerPoint or something in the meeting. So, I mean, you can.
That gets to be an open meeting law issue.
Okay. So.
If you're sending us background material,
not if they didn't go over the PowerPoint at all in the meeting, and I only sent it to the committee, that would be an open meeting law issue. Because then the committee members would have something that's not otherwise accessible.
Yeah, so our material's not accessible. Couldn't it become part of their application online?
It's true.
I'm not understanding. But I made a good point that the people that apply don't.
Further discussion on this, Dave? Any more discussion on the process of the Q&A next meeting? Dave, another additional agenda items?
Last year, the CPA Coalition said they were going to have their annual meeting training here in Northampton.
They didn't do that.
And they didn't do it. Did they, have they been in communication at all regarding their plans?
I mean, they sent out their newsletters.
Do they have an annual meeting workshop?
Don't know.
Skip us or find another community that's better?
It's not so much based on community, it's just whatever happens to work best for their purposes at that time. Let's see. I don't know
if they still do contact them. I don't know if they wondered what was happening to that idea.
Oh, it's gone. I asked them all when it was initially pushed off, and I said they just weren't having it.
So I think we ask them again. The whole point was to spread that around the state.
I don't think they did one at all.
That's one solution.
For our $5,000 a year, it would be nice to get.
What's that, $5,000? I think it's $9,000.
What?
It's going up.
$9,000.
Or $8,000, $9,000? Whatever we have to do with. But it's not $5,000 anymore.
Any other little additions to the agenda? If not, is there a motion?
One question, sorry. No, you almost got it. It was pretty close. What year is this for the committee? How long have we been doing this? Right. Sorry?
2008.
2008, okay.
I'm sorry, what was the question?
The question is, how long has this committee been in existence?
2005. Sarah?
Fiscal year 08 was the first.
So that would be 2007. Okay. I was thinking, just to finish the thought, I'll be quick, but at some point, I think it would be impressive to Northampton if we could have, I don't know, maybe on the second floor of Forbes or something, but a photographic display, one mm-hmm. photograph of every project that we have supported, and let the public see all the things that they have supported, and have perhaps one, have an opening night with some wine and cheese or something, and have, you know, a few of the key speakers come and talk about Forbes Library or the fields or the
people. Yeah, I think it's
just a big thing. Like, look at all that we've done, because by this point, I've sat through, you know, quite a number of rounds, and we've funded an awful lot of things, and I'm not sure the public fully knows it. So if we could have something up, we have an opening thing, and then leave it up for whatever they do, 3 weeks, 4 weeks.
84 projects today. 84 projects.
Yeah.
One thought would be to do it as a 10th anniversary. So do it in the fall of 17.
It would take, and if we start planning now, we can get photographs of everything.
Yeah. Well, I think that's one of the things at one point when we were drafting the new contract language, we included a provision that said applicants will be prepared to submit photographic evidence and come in and do the dog and pony show or the PowerPoint or whatever. Just for that purpose, that we could use that as a marketing tool.
Right.
We can use those materials.
And I can think of many projects that may do that.
Yeah.
Is that a great idea, Bill?
Yeah.
I like your idea. This is a publicity announcement, but it's about something that we had funded. Lori Sanders gave a talk last Sunday that was organized by the Historic Society. There are 5 more of them every other Sunday, so not this coming, but the one after. I'm not sure of the location, but I was blown away by the quality of the talk. Some of the talk material will come from her work on surveying the conservation lands. So just FYI, I would have been disappointed if I missed it.
Did anybody take that? Because I saw that it was happening and I could not get there.
Yeah, that's true for the others. I actually went by the planning office today to get a phone number to talk to her about doing that, and then I realized it's in the application that we have here, so I will talk to her about doing that.
Bring out NCT.
Yeah, no, it was
just
amazing.
Lori is a marvelous presenter.
Yeah.
And the just reading her reports is marvelous writing.
And I did send that link out to everybody. It's it's a pretty neat plan. And it's fairly recent, and the Conservation Commission hasn't had to digest it yet, but if you'd like to read it, please do so. It's great.
Is there a motion to adjourn?
Motion to adjourn.
So moved.